We're here to talk about our new event, the Beastmoon Hunt. It's on test right now, and by the time you see this, it will be on live, and we hope you're all playing with us. And I say playing with us because we all can't stop playing it. It's so much fun. This is Artie Rogers. He's a designer on our team who was really at the core of Battlegrounds design. Battlegrounds? I'm calling it Battlegrounds because that was our code name for it. Battlegrounds, right? Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. And Artie actually shipped Wizard 101 with us. Yeah. And he's returning back to the team this year, so we're excited to have him back. That's and cool. This is Ratbeard, Ben Durbin. He's been in the last couple of these videos, so y'all know him real well. He's our lead designer. What is Beastmoon Hunt, and what inspired us to make Beastmoon Hunt?
When I came back to Wizard, I was kind of like looking at different ways to see if how we could make some of our systems current. PvP and how we might be able to explore different aspects of PvP. Not something to supplant ranked, but just something to sort of, you know, look at the market. Where's the market gone since the original ranked PvP was sort of designed for Wizard, which was ages ago.
Long time ago.
Yeah, and so... And
almost 10 years ago, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, and so almost 10 years ago. The first thing was is kind of look at the different game modes that were out there and to see what might fit Wizard's unique cinematic card combat style. The other thing that I was looking at was how could we create more team reliance, mm-hmm. players relying on other players, you know, and if you know, some of the hallmarks of card games in general are just combos, being able to combo one card off of another card, but given Wizard's combat, you know, you play one card. Mm-hmm. And so the best way to do that, and that's why those sorts of concepts wedded well together. Like we need, you know, card combat is about anticipating executing on combinations and we want players to work together. So what better way to do it than have player cooperation enable the execution of these combos?
Beasts need each other.
It's true. That's true. Because we're adding another layer of complexity to combat, we needed to really kind of revisit Wizard's combat from the ground up.
We'd actually been looped into the process on PvP as consulting when Artie and I both were on different projects, and mm-hmm. so that sort of gave us an insight into some of the things in PvP that players had expressed some frustration with. And I already knew that we had some tech that was in development. Spell truncation is one mm-hmm. you mentioned, where we cut or summarize the summon sequence of it, so the spells go a lot faster.
We've been looking into that for years.
Yeah. And so, you know, a lot of the stuff that we might eventually hope to take into ranked PvP, this was a place for us, an opportunity for us to try some of these things out before we do ranked PvP. What I don't want to take ranked PvP, and I didn't want to sort of chip away at it one piece at a time. I think that community has been waiting a while for, I don't want to say reboot, but they're looking for a fix. And so I didn't want them to see a little bit of everything at a time. And so we can do the little bit of everything at a time in the Beastmoon Hunt, and then when we're ready for ranked PvP, after bringing in the community, I hope, and getting some feedback on that.
Absolutely.
Yeah, we can make a new age is how you guys would consider mm-hmm. it. Maybe look at getting all the fixes in one place at a time. So Beastmoon, if you're into PvP, then coming to the Beastmoon Hunt is a good place to see the kinds of things that we might bring over, give us mm-hmm. feedback on that. And if you're not into PvP, then I would say try the Beastmoon Hunt because it may address some of the reasons that you weren't interested in PvP in the first place.
How do you get started? This event's running. We typically are going to plan to run it about once a month opposite the Deckathalon for now. So the event's on. How do you get in?
Click on Gamma up on the main HUD and you'll see Beastmoon Hunt in the list. And then you can click on it and you'll see a button that says join match. And that's the fastest way, just jump in if you don't really, you know, if you want to learn by doing.
If you're not into,
that's what
it's
saying.
If you're not into tutorials, yeah. Yeah.
Alternatively, you can go to the duel arena and you'll see an NPC there, Artemis, who yep. can explain, give you an overview of what the match is and the hunt is and all these other things. And then there's a book there where you can look at all the different beasts you can become mm-hmm. and kind of see their spells and see how some beast spells work with well with other beasts to kind of get a better sense of if I choose this beast, then I will be able to combo with this other one. So just to be more familiar with what you're playing with.
That's interesting you mentioned that. I think right now players are so new to the event and the experience. I think a lot of players right now are rushing in and picking the form that they like the most.
The one that looks the coolest?
The one that, yeah. I know where mine is, and I don't want to say which one is my favorite because then someone will get it, but I know where they all are, so as soon as I zone in, I know exactly where to run to get mine selected. But I think as time goes on, the smarter players will wait to see what their teammates are choosing and then choose the guys that they know combo off it, because it's just so much more satisfying to get those combo effects off of your spells when you cast them. So maybe I should do that. I would win more, I think.
Well, and the
maybe you should,
depending on who's playing against you.
Yeah. Our Rochambeau, right? The image that you'd see in the upper left when you're in a match, and then Artemis mentions it in her conversation tutorializing the Beastmoon Hunt. You can use, not only do you gain a damage advantage, it shows the damage advantages that each of the schools bring, but it also implies some synergistic and counterplay. So while Storm has just a base damage modifier against fire, because that Storm dominates fire, it also does things against what fire is doing, like it can extinguish dots and things like that. So. And even when looking at that, the image, it can inform you, like, if I'm this school beast, then it might be better if I run with ones that are adjacent and then versus ones that aren't.
How do you level up? How do you level up the beasts?
Two different progression tracks we have. We have leveling and then we have tiering. Mm-hmm. For leveling, the initial levels are easy, right? You just go and you play a match, and then you'll get Lunari from the conclusion of the match, and then you can go ahead and get that first level pretty easily. After that, you need to take your Beastmoon Blossom seeds that you get at the end of the match and plant them in your Beastmoon planters.
Oh, so we garden.
You do.
We garden.
Yes. And at the conclusion of your first mm-hmm. match, you'll earn a badge that will give you two pots of Beastmoon soil.
Okay.
And then you go and plant these things. These don't have likes or dislikes, and they're their maturation time is a lot faster.
We called it gardening light.
Right.
Which is it's gardening, but it's not quite as complicated as regular gardening.
Right.
Yeah.
As a result of harvesting that first blossom, you have you may be able to craft the next set of seeds, which will be the spiritual elemental mm-hmm. Seeds. And then from there, you'll get specific schools as a result of harvesting those seeds, and so on and so forth. And the moonstones that come out of each progressively more a rarer seed will allow you to level deeper into the polymorph.
So you get the Beastmoon Blossom, and then you'll get a seed out of that that's either the
Elemental,
and then spiritual. You get the class-based one.
Yeah.
So you have to kind of do this three-tiered gardening progression.
It grows like a tree.
Right. Yeah.
Spreads out as you get.
And it just what it does is it allows the players again like some agency in which direction of this sort of growth tree they want to go.
What they want to pursue.
Where they want to mm-hmm. where they want to go, because that's where they'll pool their resources. But leveling's super important because you'll get extra new spells for each level you go up. And then at level 3 and 5, you'll get your hand size increases by 1.
One is permanent, one is temporary, right?
Right. Tiering is permanent. And tiering, you need at the harvesting the final version of a blossom can result in a polymorph statuette as a result of harvesting. And those are used for tiering.
Okay.
And tiering is permanent. And it's also important because the way that you manipulate your deck, the way that you can modify your deck in Beastmoon Hunt is you purchase battle cards from a battle card vendor in the match.
The sideboard.
Right, your sideboard, your battle card sideboard. And that it allows you to increase the number of copies you have of any specific spell in your deck, which of course for card players, they understand that it increases the chance that you draw that card.
Mm-hmm.
So it's super important. And what tiering does is increases the size of that sideboard.
Stacks your deck, if you will.
It does. Mm-hmm. Now, the sideboard functions is fundamentally different than in normal Wizard combat.
Right.
In this case, these cards are shuffled into your deck. Right. You can't draw them explicitly.
So. Right. You don't discard and draw to grab from the sideboard. Each time you get a battle card, whether you buy it from the vendor or pick it up in a chest, it's automatically just shuffled right into your deck.
Right.
So it'll come in automatically.
Right.
Players are going to have to make a decision whether they want to level up, which is temporary and gets you more power that you can use in the match, or to tier up, which is at the very basic level unlocking each new beast form. So mm-hmm. when we run the event, we have the ability to tell the event to make all of the beast forms available. We tell them which ones are available to all players. We will occasionally pull guys off of that rotation. So if you haven't unlocked your favorite guy mm-hmm. and he comes out of the rotation, you won't have access to him anymore. So players will probably want to unlock those guys, go from tier 0 to tier 1, so that even if we pull up your favorite guy off the rotation for a particular match,
you'll be able to still access him.
You can still get that guy and use it.
Right.
Yeah,
right.
Forever.
Right. So. We created how many new spells?
Over 100.
Over 100.
Over 100.
That's a lot, you guys.
Yeah, plans for a lot more, time. Too.
Yeah,
it took a while.
For sure. Some of them we created several times each.
That's true. Well, that's just how it goes. You know?
Trying to make it work.
Yeah,
Make it work. Why did we decide to make all new spells instead of just tweaking the spells that we had? And do you think it paid off?
What we wanted to do is try to make the actual combat, you know, more strategic. There's not as much depth of progression as you get in PvE, mm-hmm. where you have a lot of equipment itemization that impacts sort of how you build your deck, etc. And we also knew that the cards fundamentally were going to have a layer of complexity that most cards don't have in normal PvE. And so that led to wanting to try to make the numbers and the math simple between how these cards interact so that the players can focus more on those secondary synergies, which is what we're looking for. What we needed in order to further create this reliance on other beasts, we needed to make sure that each beast's play style and role within a combat was more or less clearly defined and also siloed to an extent. In the Beastmoon Hunt, the Ice Colossus, he's your tank, and you're not going to be killing many things with it. But what you can do is you can keep the people who do kill stuff alive. What we wanted is this to be more like a card game.
Yeah, there's no mana. Everybody has a set amount of health.
Mm-hmm. Accuracy's 100%.
Fizzles. Yep, no fizzles. No fizzles. So
unless someone casts the
accuracy. Yeah, that happens to me so often, and it just
who has
makes
that
me
one?
So
the
sad.
Minotaur.
The Minotaur.
I'm always fighting Minotaurs, I guess.
The spells themselves, I think. I mean, although some of the symbols are different, so they feel a little different. Players, the spells are actually really, really simple because we want the players to be thinking about the bigger picture of how the spells work together. That's where the complexity of the spells comes in, is whether or not you're going to get that secondary effect.
Mm-hmm.
And I like to call that, that's our PvP accelerator, that second effect usually. So you can sort of play the basic effect on the card over and over, but if you're paying attention to what's happening in the match and you're looking for those combos, you're basically getting two spells for one inside each one.
So if there's a trap, do this. Yeah.
You can. So combat just goes super, super fast.
While we do have a turn-based combat system, and we wanted to be strategic, we also had to be very careful about pacing. We didn't want to have these combats go for 15, 20 minutes. So
no,
that's
what we were hoping a match would go for.
Right.
Yeah.
So we really needed to control the health. We really needed to control the damage output and then try to get a average turn amount per combat to kind of keep things kind of going.
I think over time, the schools, you know, as we respond to player requests to have...
They've kind of converged a little bit.
Yeah, they've converged a little bit. So, you know, everybody kind of has a little bit of healing. Everybody has a few AoEs. Well, we didn't come in with those notions. We still had, I thought, a more pure version of what the school should be.
Fire should be dots.
We knew that fire was dots. We knew that ice was shielding. We knew that storm was damage. We knew that death had drains. And so we were able to come back in with a lot of that stuff and really make the schools feel unique, or already did, I should say, did a good job at it.
That was a challenge, like trying to look at the wide array of spell effects we already have available to us and then make sure we can kind of partition them out, divvy them out amongst the schools, so each school has its own sort of play style.
Now you know how Beastmoon Hunt came to be and some history behind it. Next time, we'll talk about how to really rock the Beastmoon Hunt, how to win, how to do really well. Right?
Can we do that?
All right, yeah, we'll have to let Ben in on it because his record isn't so great. We'll see you next time. Thank you very much for tuning in. See you soon.
See you.